Good morning and welcome to the 21st meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2022. Our first item of business is an evidence session with the Scottish Qualifications Authority, and I would like to welcome Fiona Robertson, Chief Executive, Michael Baxter, Director of Finance and Corporate Services, and Robert Quinn, who's Head of English, Languages and Business. And I'm sure we will have a lot of ground to cover this morning, so I would like to invite Fiona Robertson to make a short opening statement before we move on to questions. Ms Robertson, over to you. You have up to 2 minutes.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to members of the committee. And thank you for the opportunity to appear this morning to reflect on national qualifications in 2022 and to look ahead to 2023 and beyond. Firstly, I'd like to pay tribute to the 138,000 learners across Scotland who received their certificates on the 9th of August. They can feel proud of their achievements across a wide range of national and vocational qualifications and have full confidence in the results as they progress to their next stage of learning, training or employment. I think you'll all agree that they've shown remarkable resilience and commitment during a period of disruption. I'm also grateful to our partners across Scotland who through the NQ and HNVQ groups have helped to shape and agree the approach to assessment this year. Their voices, views and experience are incredibly important to us and inform the work that we do. Of course, this is the first year that SQA exams, in addition to coursework and other assessments, have taken place since 2019, but this year did not mark a return to normality. Learners faced further disruption to all aspects of their lives on the back of 2 years of previous disruption, and they've shown tremendous commitment and resilience. To help offset that disruption, SQA and the wider education system put in place a wide-ranging package of support to limit the impact of the pandemic on learners and help them perform to their best whilst maintaining the credibility of our qualifications. The package of support included course modifications to reduce the volume of assessment and ease learner and teacher workload, for example, removing or reducing elements of an exam or coursework. An exceptional circumstances service to ensure learners who could not attend an exam for reasons such as bereavement or illness, including COVID-19, could have their alternative evidence considered and still receive a grade on results day. Online advice, revision support and learner support from across the sector, including Education Scotland, schools, colleges and local authorities. A more generous approach to grading exams, and a free appeal service, which for this year included the consideration of alternative evidence that enables learners to appeal directly to SQA or through their school, college or training provider. This package of support from across the education community has delivered. While the significantly different circumstances and awarding processes of the last 4 years do not allow for conclusions to be drawn on changes in educational performance, I can say that this year's learners achieved a strong performance overall, and indeed one of the strongest to date in an exam year. Our focus now is on delivering the appeal service, which opened on results day. A priority service was in place for those appeals relating to a learner's place at university or college, a training placement or employment. Our markers and assessors have already worked through the 1,419 priority appeals, and the outcomes were communicated to centres on Monday and to UCAS yesterday. We've received over 55,000 standard appeals following the closure of the service on Friday, and we will report on the overall outcomes of both priority and standard appeals at the end of the year as normal. I appreciate there's been concern about the impact of potential industrial action at SQA on the appeals process. I share that concern. I can confirm that following agreement by the Scottish Government, a revised pay offer was put to SQA unions on Monday night, and I hope they will accept. Finally, but importantly, Results Day also saw the celebration of learners with a tremendous breadth of achievement, with awards in areas including leadership, employability, personal finance, as well as a range of skills for work courses, national certificates, awards, national progression awards. It was also a day to reflect on the achievements of many learners who received certificates throughout the year, including higher national and Scottish vocational qualifications and those undertaking foundation apprenticeships. I fully appreciate the focus on national qualifications, but learners across Scotland achieved a wide range of awards. These wide range of SQA qualifications are supporting young people as they progress to college, university, apprenticeships, other learning, training or employment. I'll just briefly say a word about awarding and reform. I know the committee is interested in awarding in 2023 and also reform. I can confirm that we are currently considering our arrangements for awarding in 2023. We all recognise that the disruption to learning and teaching caused by COVID-19 will have an impact on learners for some time to come. And to that end, we confirm that modifications to assessment will remain in place for 2022-23, which will provide certainty for learning and teaching, and that's been welcomed by the profession. Yesterday, I was pleased to chair the first meeting of the National Qualifications 2023 group, which draws membership from across the education community and also includes parent and learner representatives. The NQ group agreed that we need to work at pace, but also consider arrangements carefully, drawing on the experience and evidence from this year. And finally, on reform, we obviously continue to look to the future and are playing our full part in taking forward the Scottish Government's wide-ranging reform of education, including Professor Louise Hayward's independent review of the future of qualifications and assessment in Scotland and the forthcoming national discussion on the future of education. We're committed to making a positive contribution to these important pieces of work, the results of which will help to inform the creation of the new qualifications body, as well as a new national agency for Scottish education and an independent inspectorate. SQA has a unique place in Scottish education, and our colleagues are sharing their expertise, knowledge and experience to inform future change and support a smooth transition to the new education bodies. The global events of the last 2 years have brought significant uncertainty for learners and for everyone in education and training, with all of us, including SQA, but also notably learners, teachers
and lecturers. Can I ask you to draw your remarks to a conclusion, please, Fiona?
Absolutely. I've got just 30 seconds more, if I may.
If you can draw them, it was 2 minutes, and we've had nearly five.
Okay. Well, I'll just conclude by saying, I hope that everyone, including members of the committee, will get behind our work to deliver for learners and to invest in the future, including the future National Qualifications Body. And I'm very happy to answer any questions. Apologies,
that's fine.
As you highlighted, there's quite a lot to cover, and I hope in my opening remarks I've been able to give an overview of the work that we've been doing. Thank you.
I'm certain that your opening remarks, which are very grateful, will form a thread for some of the themes and the questions that we've got lined up today. Can I start off by something? You spoke at length there about some of the modifications and the changes that you've made. The Chief Examining Officer's report stated that the education system has taken steps to ensure the continuity of learning and teaching, and that the SQA have developed an assessment and awarding approach that has helped to address disruption to learning, but it has not been a normal year. That reiterates what you've just outlined to us today. But what are some of the details? I mean, you gave a broad overview there in terms of the actual methodology and approach that you've taken.
So I set out in my opening statement a package of measures that SQA have taken, alongside obviously a lot of support and guidance that's taken place right across the education system to ensure that learners have that there's continuity of learning and teaching, and learners have had the best chance of success in achieving qualifications. The modifications to assessment were first put in place in academic year 2020-21. And that followed a wide-ranging public consultation, and we have confirmed arrangements in both 2021-22 and now into 2022-23. We have made some adjustments to those modifications based on feedback from practitioners, and it's reflected a number of things. We have over 120 courses across National 5, Higher and Advanced Higher, and it was important that those modifications reflected the assessment approach that is in place for each of those courses, and therefore was bespoke to those arrangements. So for some courses, we removed coursework to free up time for learning and teaching. For other courses, we narrowed some elements of the assessment, and a range of other things. This year we also introduced revision support, which again combined a variety of different approaches to different courses, and that would include, for example, advanced notification of topics that may come up, or indeed topics which may not come up, So there was a range of measures that we took around modifications to assessment and giving learners advance notification of elements of their assessment which may come up in the exam. My colleague Robert Quinn, I'm sure, would be very happy to provide some further detail on individual subjects if that's of interest to the committee.
Perhaps if you want to give a couple of examples, that'd be helpful.
Yeah, thanks Fiona, thanks convener. The key thing there was about pragmatically trying to reduce the requirements but still preserve performance standards and the credibility qualifications. So in a subject like English, for example, the requirement to formally assess speaking and listening was removed, but with the key advice to still develop these key skills. We reduced the writing requirement. Normally, learners would provide a folio of writing, creative and broadly creative and broadly discursive. So we reduced that to one piece rather than two. The expectation is still develop the whole full range of writing styles, but we'd only have to formally submit one. And also in the context of revision support in the run-up to the examination, we provided them with the specifics of the set text in the Scottish set text section of the assessment. So, for example, if they had to study six poems, we would give them an indication of the poem that was coming up in the assessment. But, of course, in the actual assessment itself, examination itself, they do have to reflect on their wider reading. So it's not like we were actually reducing or narrowing their reading, but we were providing a degree of certainty and potentially trying to de-stress the situation in the run-up to the examination. In a subject like mathematics, we provided some advance notice of key content that we wouldn't be assessing. And in both those areas, actually, at the awarding process, I think we were pleased that that support had, to a degree, mitigated some of the real challenges faced by learners this year.
Thank you. I think we'll come on to questions on that, I think, from other members later on. But can I ask, go firstly to a question from Mr. Oliver Mundell, please.
Thank you, convener. This is the third time you've had a go at sort of trying to help learners. But it feels to me that you've again failed Scotland's young people. And we've seen again that the system looks after the system rather than young people. All of the measures you outline don't really deliver, and that's why we've seen a huge attainment gap. Surely you recognise the attainment gap we've seen this year is unacceptable.
Well, I think what we sought to do this year was to take every step that we could to free up learning and teaching time and provide support for learners in so doing. And that's what we sought to do. And as I say in my opening statement, I highlighted in summary the measures that we took.
Now, didn't work, though, did it? Otherwise, we wouldn't have seen the attainment gap widen back out. And you've put significant mitigations in place to adjust grade boundaries and to try and do that. And it didn't deliver. It didn't deliver the result you would expect. It delivered the status quo, going back to pre-pandemic. And all of the things you did were to make things easier for you to produce a result that was acceptable. It didn't see intensive support for young people to help them catch up on their learning, did it?
I think we took every measure that we could to provide support to learners, working, as I say, in parallel with other, including local support and support from other agencies and other parts of the education system to do so. I think I also said in my opening statement that we needed to be careful about drawing conclusions around educational performance from this year's figures, because we have had 2 years of a different assessment approach and a different pattern of results, not just a different pattern of results in Scotland, but a different pattern of results elsewhere. And on that basis, it's important to keep that context very much in mind. As again, I highlighted in my opening statement, this is a strong set of results. And Robert and myself sat in all the awarding meetings with teachers who marked, who set examinations and assessments this year. And I think we were all of the view that while the pandemic, absolutely, this was not a return to a normal year, we saw remarkable achievement from young people and resilience from young people, and the results are a testament to that. It's a strong set of results.
You can't hide behind that. that young people with the greatest educational challenges have had the least support at the most difficult point. And all of the changes you've made, you know, they tidy up the statistics, but they don't actually help those young people get the learning and the teaching and the support they should. Effectively, you're helping mask the scale of the attainment gap by making those types of changes, one, and two, the types of adjustments you've made, for example, you know, helping people prepare in advance for exams. They help the students who are doing well anyway. They help the students who are most prepared. They help the students in the schools with teachers who are able to provide that type of bespoke support. But there was nothing extra for young people who were facing the greatest challenges, and you've presided over an exam system that's accepted that unfairness. Do you not think that's wrong?
Where I agree with you is learning and teaching comes first, and therefore the learning and teaching experience that young people have received, and the measures that have been put in place locally to address differential disruption to learning remain very important. I suppose what I'm saying is we've sought to modify our approach as best we can as a national agency and as a national qualifications body to address disruption to learning.
Does it make you angry that you're presiding over an exam system that's failing our young people with the greatest educational challenges? That doesn't make you angry. It doesn't cause you to raise concern with the Scottish Government around the approach elsewhere in the system. You've come in at the end to help tidy up and mask the fact that young people have been failed again for the third year in a row.
I don't think this year's results present failure. I've highlighted the outcomes of this year and highlighted the achievements of young people. And I think we need to make sure that we reflect on that strong performance. But you know, I think it's also fair to say that a number of sources of evidence have highlighted the challenges that young people have faced. The government's own equity audit, the data relating to the broad general education through the CFE level data, and of course, head teachers who work on the Scottish Attainment Challenge have highlighted some of the difficulties during COVID impact the gap. My job is to ensure that we have fair and credible assessments and that we have played our part in addressing disruption to learning over the last couple of years, and that is what we have done. Issues in relation to differential disruption to learning and some of the different experiences that young people have faced are matters for the wider education system to consider. But we have done all we can, and we've worked very closely with the education system, with learners and with parents representatives to ensure that we've done all that we can. And that's the responsibility that we have, and that's the responsibility that we've sought to deliver on.
Thank you. I think Robert Quinn would like to comment on that as well before I bring in Graham.
Yeah, thanks very much, convener. I just want to emphasise that the support that we provided this year was not just end-loaded. It wasn't just about preparing learners to sit their examinations. We provide a lot of support for a whole wide range of qualifications. National 4, for example, we provided some support and flexibility around the added value unit. Our National Progression Awards, our National Certificates of what we did with the college sector. We introduced a decision tree for teachers and lecturers to be able to take a more holistic approach to assessment to try and mitigate some of the real challenges that learners across the spectrum would have provided. So I suppose just to clarify that point, that the whole support wasn't just end loaded, and it needed to reach across the full range of qualifications that we support. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert.
Yeah, I'm happy to end there, convener. I just say a fair education system's one where everyone has an equal opportunity.
And
I'm not clear that that's what's happened this year.
Graham Day, thank you.
Thank you, convener. I mean, if you look at this from a statistical point of view, it strikes me that 2019 and 22 are comparable in terms of assessing performance. And that indicates an improvement in closing the attainment gap, not as much as we might want, but an improvement. I just wonder, when you talk there, Fiona Robertson, about a fair and credible assessment system, how do you explain the fluctuations and those numbers in the period in between those 2 years?
First of all, we see variations in attainment across individual subjects and across levels every year, and I think that's quite important to highlight. And that's to be expected, and Scotland is not unique in that. But I think Scotland, in common with other countries, in the move to the effectively the emergency years and the pandemic years of 2020 and 21, and the move to teacher judgment, we saw a very different pattern of results, and we also saw that in other parts of the UK. So similar trends. I think it's important to take a step back and say, well, the qualification system that we have and the courses that we have been designed to support the assessment approach. So we have course specifications and we have assessment approach to ensure that the learning knowledge and skills and understanding can be appropriately assessed, so that we can fulfil our statutory functions to ensure that qualifications can be awarded, and that's an important and serious endeavour to do that. So that's the qualification system we've had, and indeed, we've had prior to 2020 we had over 130 years of an uninterrupted exam diet in Scotland. But it's important to highlight that we don't just have exams, we also have coursework, and we also have other forms of assessment as part of our overall assessment approach. And that also includes internal assessment by teachers. So teacher judgment forms an important part of our assessment approach in Scotland, even with formal external assessment. But we moved very quickly in 2020, just a matter of weeks away from an exam diet to working through some of the difficulties in awarding, and working with the system to do that. And again in 2021 when exams were cancelled, and that required teachers and lecturers to consider their own assessment requirements in 2021 with support from us, and make those judgments school by school, college by college, and we saw a very different pattern of attainment as a result. And as I say, Scotland, we're not alone in that. Returning to exams, where you have the development of assessments on a national basis, you have standardisation, you have markers working consistently, and grade boundary meetings determining the overall approach to ensure fairness across Scotland. So an A in our both is the same as an A in Aberdeen and so on, is an important feature of an external national qualification system. And it's so for a combination of factors, we've seen a different pattern of results. But as I've highlighted, and I think it's really important in the conversation to repeat, because of that different assessment approach, over the last couple of years, we do need to treat changes comparisons with some caution. So while you're absolutely right to highlight that the results in 2022 were higher than in 2019, I think it's also important to highlight that 2022 wasn't a normal year, and there were differences to the way in which we awarded in 2022 compared to 2019. But in the context of the attainment gap, I think it's also important to highlight that in 2021, with teacher judgment, there was also a slightly larger attainment gap than in 2020. So again, the attainment gap has reflected the broad pattern of results that we've seen over the last few years. I realise that's quite a long answer, but there are some complexities here that I think we need to consider quite carefully.
Yeah, and perhaps the biggest complexity at all was the impact of COVID-19 on the learning experience of these young people, and let's face it, the teaching environment for teachers.
Exactly.
So, difficult question perhaps to answer, but given that 2022 is not a direct comparator with 2019 in terms of the whole experience, Where will we be in this process before we get back to a point where you could reasonably compare a year with 2019 and then reasonably measure progress or otherwise? Are we talking about next year, the year after, when?
Yeah, I mean, I think, as I highlighted, I think there are some decisions that we need to take in relation to 2023. I mean, I think comparisons are not unimportant, but it's also important that we are cognizant of the circumstances that young people are facing and continue to face and make the right judgments in fairness to them. Because actually, while I fully appreciate that the committee is interested in national comparisons, or comparisons between years and making a determination on the performance, good or otherwise, of the Scottish education system. Behind those results are individual learners who want to progress with their learning or want to go to university.
This committee has done a piece of work on the attainment gap. And what we were looking at was, we have to, given the vast sums of money that right we're being directed to tackle this issue, we have to have some measure, some indication of progress or otherwise. It's essential. So I repeat my question, are we talking about next year or the year after, when we would reasonably be able to say, well, this is the progress that's been made over a four-year period or whatever?
Just very quickly, my sense is it'll probably take us a couple of years to recover here. As Fiona says, we saw a lot of resilience and excellence, and it's very, one of the privileges of my job is to be able to actually work with teachers and see the output of what learners, young and old, produced. But we also, it's very clear there were some areas of pandemic impact that, that we, listening in languages or, some of the practical elements in sciences, etc. And our view is that we, it will probably take a little while for that to fully recover. And that, I can't really put an exact on it, but that would be my
thank you. That's helpful.
I think the only thing I would say is that there's a distinction between between performance and the method of assessment. We've made some changes to the way in which we award, and that makes and indeed the changes to assessment over the last couple of years makes that difficult. But we, we, as Robert has said, we may see a couple of years.
Thank
more
you, Fiona. I think Graham was looking for a date or a timeline, and he got that. So, if you don't mind, Dad, can we move on to questions from Michael Mara now, please?
Okay, just a supplementary on this point. Is
yes,
that,
that's
okay.
Fine.
That's fine. Thanks, Convener. You've already recognised, I think, the panel, the impact, as we do, on young people of the pandemic in recent years. But it's also recognised in your methodology for the results that's just come out. I think we can all see that. I suppose one of the consequences of that is that there is a significant amount of lost learning for young people, and that's recognised in a curtailed assessment curriculum. So there's fewer things being assessed. And speaking to colleges and universities, employers, they are seeing the impact of that. And young people coming into the colleges and universities, techniques and labs that haven't been learned, things that haven't been assessed. Where do you think that lost learning should be made up?
I think what we've sought to do over the last couple of years is to make sure that we are maintaining the credibility of the qualifications, so therefore we're focusing on the things that are important, are most important in terms of assessment, and freeing up as much learning and teaching time as we can. So I think I would absolutely acknowledge that learning and teaching has been impacted. I think we all would, that learning and teaching has been impacted by the pandemic. But in the arrangements that we've made, including with specific qualifications, so for example, some licence to practice qualifications, it's actually really critical that that learning still takes place and is recognised as having taken place. But we've made a judgment, and we've made a judgment not just on our own, but with teachers, with the wider system, on what adjustments that we can make, which both recognise, and I think that's really a key point I'm trying to highlight here, which recognise the reality of the disruption that young people face and the disruption to learning, but also recognise that we, in fairness to them, need to make appropriate and appropriate judgments about those assessment arrangements that can be shifted. I promised going to answer your question.
Thank you.
Around the specific thing about where that's the catch up, if you like. Well, I mean, I have to say, I've heard some pretty positive feedback from colleges and from universities about that system-wide approach to ensuring that we do both take cognizance of the fact that some learners will have faced some challenges, and the ability of the system to provide that support where it's needed, and to focus on the most important issues. And as I've said, and I'll continue to say through the next couple of hours, I think we've seen remarkable.
So you think colleges and universities should make up that
no,
gap?
No. What I'm saying is, I think that the education system has worked together to ensure that we put appropriate arrangements in place to address any of those issues.
With respect, I mean, the feedback that I've had is that those gaps are definitely there, and your methodology, as we've already said, recognises that those gaps are there. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure I'm hearing where you think that should be made up, because if it's, for instance, a school leaver, somebody who's left school and going somewhere else, is it the college or the university that should make up that lost learning?
Well, I don't think it's quite as simple as that. I mean, because I think that's dependent on the circumstances of the individual learner, their achievements, and what they're going on to do. I mean, I think what I've sought to set out is, as far as SQA qualifications are concerned, we've made a judgment about the adjustments that can be made to maintain the credibility of the qualifications, so learners can move on with confidence. And if there are issues to address further down the line, then the education system is working together to do that.
Is it? Where is that happening? That's my question. So I genuinely would like to know where that is.
I think certainly in the context of the discussions that we have with universities and colleges, I think we've absolutely taken a system-wide approach in making sure that young
people... And they're being supported to do that.
That young people can make progress. I mean, the qualifications that learners have got over the last 3 years remain credible and remain such that learners can move on with confidence. And I think that's the key message here.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
I wondered, Robert, did you want to say anything on that? Are you okay?
I mean, obviously, as someone who used to work in a college, you know, I think obviously colleges are well placed for you know, to work with learners, and we see lots of examples of colleges supporting learners, you know, from different, you know, different life journeys, and it's not just unique to the pandemic, and it's a really critical sector that we work very closely with, and, you know, I feel quite strongly that they should be well placed to support that.
Thank you, Robert. I think Bob Doris has got a supplementary in this thread.
Just very briefly on it, because it's kind of the expression lost learning. There's a question later on. I'll ask part of this later on. I would ask that later on, because we're talking about lost learning because of the disruption of COVID, but also because of a slimmed down syllabus or a slimmed down external examination diet, and we're getting that again next year. I just want to be clear about the language we use. We talk about lost learning. We talk about lost learning because young people who have gaps in their learning because schools were not on. Are we talking about lost learning because of a slimmed down syllabus in the classroom, which are two different things? So I'd like to be clear about the language. And finally, Michael Mara, I don't think, did get an answer to his point about where is this mapped, where are the knock-on effects to lost learning? So, for example, in science, where it's heavily content-based, building blocks of learning, are there active discussions with universities? Because if you say a bit out of the syllabus, that has been picked up in first-year undergraduate level. So where's that mapped and where's it reported?
Just to be clear, the course specifications remain in place. The adjustments that we've made are to assessment. So we've made it clear. So, for example, coursework takes up quite a lot of time. It takes up quite a lot of time both for learners and in learning and teaching. So removing that ensures that, pardon me, I'll just have a drink. So what we've sought to do is to seek to release additional learning and teaching time. So there's more time. So I don't use the term lost learning. I think we accept that some young people have had disruption to their learning, and what we've sought to do is seek to minimise the impact of that through the measures that we've taken. But a young person getting a higher this year or a last year or the year before can have confidence in that qualification in order that they progress to their next stage in learning or indeed. And we've worked very closely with all parts of the education system to ensure that we do that. So I think it's a really important message that the qualifications that young people have achieved through the COVID years remain credible and they can
just a terminology question, and yes or no answer would be great if that's remotely possible. So for me to understand better, the syllabus did not shrink.
No.
The content did not shrink
and
won't shrink in the coming year either. It's what's externally assessed will be narrowed to allow more focus on teaching and learning. Is that a better way of putting it?
Exactly.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you very much, Mr. Dorris, and for those responses. Ruth, over to yourself now, if that's okay.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thanks for being with us. I want to ask about equalities and wonder if you can expand a bit on what the relationship is between better attainment gap in terms of the grades awarded and the attainment gaps that are identified in the SQA's equalities monitoring report, which we have in our papers here.
So since 2020, we have provided equalities analysis as part of our awarding, and we've provided some material across a range of protected characteristics. So not just the attainment gap, but other gaps which exist in Scottish education, as part of our responsibilities to ensure that we seek to explain what those are. So that material and analysis is included in the package of materials that we produce on results day. Prior to the pandemic, that was done later in the process because some of that data comes from the Scottish Government, so that's not data that we hold. And indeed, during our awarding processes, and it's part of our responsibilities to ensure fairness, we don't actually know the circumstances. So when a teacher's marking an exam script or undertaking an assessment, they will not know the individual circumstances of that learner in making that judgment. And that's an important part of the fairness and credibility of the approach that we take. But we recognise that our assessments need to be fair at the point that they're taken, reflecting the fact that young people may well have different learning experiences and face different circumstances during their education. And so we do provide some further information in relation to those gaps in the report. Is there a specific issue in relation to that analysis that you're?
I suppose I'm interested to know how you use it. I suppose when I think back on the unfairness that some children in my constituency experienced in the lower SIMD areas in terms of assessment, I'm just interested in how the SQA use this equalities data to ensure fairness. I don't know if your colleagues have further to add. Or...
I think members will recognise that we will see variability across. We will see variability in the outcomes of awarding. You know, all systems do. What we're seeking to ensure through equalities impact assessments and so on is to ensure that the method of assessment that we have is fair and credible. But I think I suppose
it would be helpful to hear how you've used that data to ensure that, you know, what changes have you made? Have you made changes ever based on the data that you've gathered that shows the disparity there for children with additional support needs or children and young people in SIMD?
We have a range of assessment arrangements in place every year, and we also provided data on results day around the assessment arrangements that had been put in place and had been requested and put in place by schools and colleges across the year. And that includes a range of measures from additional time for an exam, for special arrangements, for scribing and other things. So I think it's really important that the committee is aware that we absolutely play our part in making sure that the arrangements for assessment are such that they recognise that some young people may require additional support. Now, obviously, in 2020 and 21, schools were responsible for making sure that those arrangements were in place. So I think what we reflect on and demonstrate through our assessment arrangements is that we consider those issues in discussions with schools and make sure that those special arrangements are in place. And as part of the development of qualifications, and Robert can say a little bit more about that, we look at equalities considerations, and of course the modifications to assessment were subject to equalities analysis, etc. So that we're seeking to ensure, I think there's a distinction between the way in which we assess and the outcomes. I think we're reporting on the outcomes, but we take every measure to ensure that our assessments are fair and are fair to every learner, irrespective of their circumstances at the point at which those assessments are undertaken. But I think we'd all accept that, you know, you've had many discussions in this committee about the attainment gap and the measures that are being taken forward to address the attainment gap, and our role is to report. A part of our role is to report on that. But Robert might want to say a little bit about the development of the qualifications themselves.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose just to reassure that we take a lot of care and attention and things like, and we reflect on equalities reports and around things like context of assessment. I think we want to try and create a wide variety of assessment support and assessment approaches that you know, would ensure a broader scope of learners can access them. And actually, we've got a strong part to play in our actual qualifications portfolio itself. I could take an example of the Scots Language Award, which has got a big uptake across sectors and is pulling in a lot of learners who were previously quite disenfranchised, and they're recognising that they can engage very positively in something like that. It's a language they recognise and they can progress with, and their performance across the curriculum is improving on that basis. So there's a whole range of initiatives, I think, that we support that are reflective in what comes out of a quality monitoring reports that help us ensure we play our part along with partners.
Could you... Sorry to press convener, could you just tell me some more? I mean, that Scots language one sounds interesting, but
it's obviously we have, I think since about 2015 we've put in place a new award to study Scots in Scottish schools.
Sorry, no, you misunderstand. That was good to have a specific example there of something. Do you have some more examples that you could share with the committee? I'm asking.
Oh, right, sorry, yeah. In terms of the types, well, we put in a whole range of awards, if you like. I think which reach out. We've got Modern Language for Life and Work Award. We've got Religion and Belief Award. We've got Leadership Awards. You know, we try to recognise a broader range of skills within the senior phase. I think it's really important that we don't see moving forward the senior phase as just being about graded national courses, that it's a mixed economy of provision and it's all accredited against the SCQF, the Scottish Credit and Qualification Framework. And a lot of that unitised, smaller chunks of learning that can be accredited and certificated, I think, are worth equal celebration as our traditional qualifications. And I think the presence of that type of qualification ensures that we bring more learners into play. I said previously that my own background's in the college sector, and one of the privileges in that area was actually unearthing some diamonds and actually taking the myth and issues of the education is not for them, or achievement and attainment is not for them. So I think that whole part of actually utilising our full catalogue of qualifications and us collectively celebrating the importance of these qualifications, it's got a part to play in the context of equalities.
So there's an important piece here around the accessibility of our qualifications. We've got a wide offer. I think I've already said, there's a huge focus on National Fives, Hires and Advanced Hires, understandably so, but there's a wide range of awards that we offer. And I think we've seen in recent years more take-up of some of those qualifications, so that they're offered within schools and colleges, school-college partnerships, the development of the foundation apprenticeships, for example, so that there's diversity and choice in the offer that we have. And those include a range of assessment methods, so including internally assessed awards as well, taken when a learner's ready, rather than in the spring of each year. So there are lots of choices that we offer.
Okay, Convener, one more question.
Yeah, please.
Can I ask you how you ensure that assessment methods don't under or overstate the attainment gaps?
Yeah, I think it's. I think what we seek to do is we seek to provide, in the development of our qualifications, working closely with teachers, and I think it's really important that you know, we have national qualification subject teams, we've got teachers setting and marking exams, that we ensure that that the qualifications are accessible to all. Now, I think we would reflect on the fact that the learning and teaching experience might be different before that point, and indeed there may be variation in performance, and we've seen that for many years in Scotland, but we have a responsibility to ensure that our assessment approach is fair, and we seek to do that. I think the experience of the last couple of years has thrown up, and the move to teacher judgment has, despite what I've said around the comparisons, has raised this question around attainment gaps. But I think it's really important to highlight that the part that we play in both assessing young people and reporting on the performance of the education system is fair, and our systems and the checks and balances that we have in the system ensure that they are. But I think that the question is quite difficult to answer on the basis that that we are reporting on the outcomes of learning and teaching, and therefore we need to demonstrate that our assessment processes are fair. The attainment cap may vary or change for other reasons.
Coming on. Thank you very much, Fiona. Yes, Robert.
It's a good question, and I think it's a challenging question, but I think the key thing for me is to make sure the assessment is as valid as it can be. It assesses the skills, knowledge and understanding that it's designed for. So, for example, if we're trying to assess more of a process and a reflective part of that and lessons learned, etc., you know, maybe some of the then clearly, you know, an examination type assessment is not the most appropriate there, and we need to have, you know, another type of assessment. And obviously that's more internally focused, and that's right and proper. And then once you've decided on what's the most valid way to do it, how do you reliably assess it? I mean, clearly examinations can standardise and help give you that level playing field. But there are certain areas where that's not appropriate, and you know, we need elements like coursework, personalisation and choice, etc. So I think the key thing for me is just a bit of care and attention to the actual assessment approaches we're set up to make sure it's as broad and accessible as possible, and also assessing the skills that it's designed to assess, and also then trying to deal with that challenge of how we reliably ensure fairness in terms of that assessment. So there's, whatever way you look at it, there's challenges, and it's all about balance.
Thank you very much. Mr. Yuki?
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Willie Rennie, thanks.
Thank you very much. I was a wee bit surprised that you struggled to answer that last question, because I thought it was fundamental to what you were doing to make sure that what you were measuring didn't overestimate or underestimate state. But you've admitted that it was difficult, so I'm puzzled by that. But we'll move on. Following Ken Muir's evidence to the committee in March, David Middleton, the chair, rebutted some of the evidence. He said that he was surprised and disappointed, and he played back Professor Muir's words to him. Did you agree with David Middleton's statement?
Well, you're quite right that the chair of the SQA replied to some of the commentary and the subsequent reporting of
reply, though, wasn't it? I mean, it was a rebuttal. It was quite stinging.
Yes.
And I was quite surprised by it. And I just wondered if you agreed to it.
Well, in short, yes.
Okay. And does that kind of reveal a tension in the whole reform debate? Do you disagree more broadly with Professor Muir's approach? What does this reveal? Because, you know, we hadn't seen that before then. And I'm just wondering if you could just tell us what's going on.
I mean, I don't think it revealed attention.
Why was it necessary?
I think it revealed a response to what was said, which I think it's fair to say came as something of a surprise. I think there was a lot of material in Ken's report that we agreed with, and that we had the opportunity to discuss a number of issues with Professor Muir. During the course of his review, and me and my senior team did, and as did the wider organisation, and we're grateful to Ken for that. So therefore we were surprised by some of Ken's comments and disappointed by some of Ken's comments, subsequent comments, because they didn't align with the experience and the discussion that we'd had, or indeed actually in some respects the tenor of the report itself. So I think the chair's statements were from the chair, and you obviously would be free to ask the chair himself his thinking, but I think it does reflect the broader feeling across the organisation after Ken's
So can you tell us a bit more about what you disagreed with, what you said?
Well, I think the chair's statement highlights some of those areas around what Ken said at the committee. I think we agreed with
I just want to know what you, because you know you agreed to the statement. You must know what was in the statement. What was it that you didn't agree with?
I don't have the statement.
Well, it was a pretty big statement. I would have thought you would have it with you today.
I absolutely recall the statement and the context in which the statement was made. I think the chair was reflecting on the issues that Ken had raised at the meeting. I don't think
that's fine, Fiona.
I don't think there's anything more to say about that really.
Can we move on, please, Mr. Rennie?
I mean, what I'm getting at here is there's many in the profession think that there's going to be no change as a result of this process. All it's going to result in is a change in the names and everything else will carry on. And this exchange between the chairman and the professor, I think, perhaps lifted a bit of a lid into that. And I'm just wondering, can you convince us that reforms will happen?
Willie, sorry, can we move on?
I do actually have the statement in front
okay.
of me, and I'm happy to quote from the statement, which says that we agree with Professor Muir that education reform is needed with learners at the centre, and there's real appetite for change within the SQA. So I don't think it does. I don't think it does highlight what you've just said.
I said I was surprised and disappointed, but yeah. Right, okay. Can I ask another slightly other
if it's,
area?
If it's off that topic, that would be helpful.
Yeah, it is off that topic. Broad general education to the senior phase, there's been a lot of comment about the stark contrast between the two, and many blame the SQA for that stark contrast. What's your assessment of that? Do you think you're responsible for it? And if not, why not?
I've been party to a lot of conversations over many years, both in SQA and previous to that, around the transition between the broad general education and the senior phase. I think the curriculum for excellence was developed on the basis that it was a 3-18 curriculum, and there was a smooth transition through the broad general education to the senior phase. I think there's been a lot of focus on ensuring that transitions at all points in the education system are as smooth and as effective as possible, both from the early years into primary and so on, and similarly from primary into secondary. But I think we also appreciate that there's been a particular focus, as you said, on the move from BGE to the senior phase. I think what we sought to do and we have to do as part of our responsibilities is to provide clarity on the expectations, and indeed the education system expects clarity on what it is, as Robert has said, on how we develop the qualifications, what skills, knowledge and understanding is expected in order to gain a qualification. So there's a degree of formality about that. So I think it's important that we do that, and we do that in the best way possible, drawing on the Curriculum for Excellence levels and the work that Education Scotland has done around ensuring that there's a clear understanding with the system on what the CFE levels are through the broad general education to ensure that smooth transition. I think there's always room for improvement.
It's more than that, though, isn't it? It's more than just room for improvement. There's been a lot of criticism that the two-term dash to the exams, when we've been moving from a broad general education in the principles of the Curriculum for Excellence straight into a mad dash for exams. And that's your fault, isn't it?
No, I don't think it is, actually. I think if you go back to building the curriculum documents as part of the development of CFE, and I know Louise Hayward will be looking at some of these issues, I think there was an aspiration that we would be moving to ensure that there was a smoother transition into the senior phase, and that there would be flexibility in the curriculum design and development in ensuring that young people would have more choice about when they sat exams and whether some exams, for example, should be bypassed and so on. So I think these are issues that continue to be discussed within Scottish education. Curriculum choices and issues around curriculum design in an empowered system are taken at a local level, and we have a very clear offer in terms of our qualifications and clear requirements, and we continue, and absolutely we're developed in concert with the system, and we continue to discuss to ensure that they work as well as they can. But I think it is a legitimate issue for Louise Hayward to consider as part of her review of assessment and qualifications, because we all want to make sure that our learners have the best experience. Assessment doesn't start in the senior phase. Assessment is part and parcel of learning and teaching. Good assessment is part and parcel of good learning and teaching. And what we all want to ensure is the smoothest transition for our children between the experience that they have in primary school and the early parts of secondary school and into the senior phase.
So some have argued that we should be stripping back exams to quite a significant effect. Do you agree with that?
Well, I know the committee took evidence from Gordon Stobart, and I think Gordon Stobart's review as part of the OECD work did highlight whether we should have, you know, S4, S5 and S6 exams. And as I say, I think that's something for Louise Hayward to consider.
Do you have a view?
Well, when we look back, I mean, in a previous life, I chaired the Curriculum for Excellence Management Board when I worked in the government, and I was certainly party to conversations at that time as part of the development of Curriculum for Excellence young people would undertake perhaps undertake a different pattern of qualifications over their senior phase, and that there was an aspiration of that. So I think I think there has been some developments in that context, but that's not.
I was just asking what you think. I know you've described what other people thought, but what I want to know is what you think.
I think Robert's also wanting to answer and say what he thinks as well on this one.
The honest truth is, I think I want to make sure that young people have the best learning and teaching experience that they can, and that they take qualifications at the point at which that makes sense to them, and that young people have choice and are able to exercise that choice through the work that a school and college does. Now you might.
That's a brilliant non-answer.
You're looking as if that's not quite the answer that you wanted. But I think that's no. But that's
perhaps
that's
Robert
the,
can.
That's the answer that I'm willing to
provide. Let's see
if Robert
can have a stab at it. Yeah.
Thank you, Robert.
Okay, thanks for that. Yeah, I want a full catalogue to be recognised. I want people to have a choice. I want there to be less absolute focus on national courses, and I want us to celebrate all qualifications against the SCQF, and I want to have the flexibility of that within the senior phase to celebrate the move through from the broad general education. I think all types of qualifications that we have their place and are key and are important, but I think we need to recognise the totality of what young people have. So it's a mix of hires or National Fives or National Progression Awards. If they're interested in sound, if they're interested in music, do something in sound production at a local college or whatever and as part of the senior phase, and we all collectively celebrate that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. And can I hand over to COCAB Stewart, please, Vice Convener.
Thank you, Convener. I'm going to sort of look at outcomes and just move things forward a wee bit. I just wanted to start off on a positive thing. On Results Day, a quote from an open letter from a range of Scotland's employers, representative groups and others was published, and they did say that we want to reassure you that we recognise and value your qualifications as much as any other year, and the skills that you have developed and will continue to develop will play a crucial role in ensuring a bright future for businesses in Scotland and our economy. So I'm sure that our youngsters were very heartened to hear that, but we do know that, and we're acutely aware of the changing needs of the employment sector, and I'm not just talking about business here, I'm also talking about social care and public sector, covering all of those. So we know that there is a changing need and some of the jobs don't yet exist, so that is a challenge regarding the skills, knowledge, as well as attitudes and behaviours that are required. So how does the SQA work with employers and further and higher education providers to ensure that the qualifications support colleagues, candidates, our young people, to the next stage of their learning journey?
Thank you. Well, I would agree it was really pleasing to see the open letter from Sandy Begbie and others on behalf of businesses on Results Day, because I think it's a really important message. The credibility and public confidence in our qualifications is really important, and it's really important for learners. Our work with employers is threaded through the work that we do to develop our qualifications, from the creation of new qualifications to the validation of group awards. So there's lots of engagement with employers through the process, the detailed process of individual qualifications. And that would include, for example, the care sector or the construction sector, for example. And of course, some employer organisations, which are the kind of convening space for businesses as well. So we do work very closely with employer organisations and sector skills councils for some of our qualifications, many of our qualifications. The Scottish Training Federation sits on our advisory council. I think the director of the CBI in the past has been on our board, for example. And employers have also played a really important role in the development of our next generation of higher national qualifications. So a lot of that work is done in the very much in the detail of what we do. And of course, it's important to highlight that many employers both offer and deliver our qualifications as well. And just finally, I would also say the engagement that we have with the college sector specifically and Skills Development Scotland is really important here in the work that we do to ensure that our qualifications and the assessment approach that supports our qualifications are right. So, that's key.
And do you think that the SQA is flexible enough to be able to, because I'm interested in the future, and obviously skills are changing and demands are changing, and I'm hearing from employers that, crafting a new sort of like diet and that will also require assessment and a robust level that's recognised. So do you think that the SQA is flexible and robust enough to be able to respond to that need? And what about the timescales? Because we know that there's skill shortages and things. So how long, it would be good to know how long it can take to actually develop a qualification and then assess it and people coming through.
Robert can say a little bit more about that detailed development process. I think we're always taking work forward with with a number of organisations, including employer representatives, employer organisations, to consider what further developments we need to take forward on our qualifications. And as I mentioned, that the next generation of HN qualifications is a key case in point. There's always more that we would like to do. We have quite an extensive catalogue of qualifications, and it can be difficult to satisfy the needs of all in all of that, both in terms of making sure that that catalogue continues to develop and be updated, and also with the development of new qualifications as well. And I think that's something that, in the context of reform and in developing a new qualifications body, that's one area that I certainly would like to explore further, because there's certainly no shortage of ambition either from employers or indeed within the SQA to do that. But I think it's fair to say we always have to take some quite difficult choices on these issues with fixed capacity, etc. But Robert might want to say a little bit about more about the development. There's some really good, some great work going on HN Next Generation, for example.
Yeah, I mean, your point about timeliness is a well-made point, and I think one of the things that we can do within HN Next Generation, for example, which we've agreed in partnership with the college sector and also with university partners as well, is that we can prototype. So we can quickly develop and prototype approaches to assessment and qualifications, try things out. It's a space that's probably slightly less political, less content, there's probably more opportunity for us to do that type of thing. Things like meta skills is the kind of one of the key things, attitude, resilience, sustainability. You know, we've got a requirement that all next gen HNs have a demonstrated element of sustainability within the teaching, learning and assessment process. So, but I think that prototyping is something that we're doing differently here, you know, where we're taking a few areas, we're creating a minimal viable product, we're taking it out with what we call pilot colleges who've applied to us through a bidding process, and they are then prototyping. We did it with radio and TV, for example. We did 1 year of prototyping on television, and then we're doing an evaluation with the learners at the heart of that, and then obviously that informs the further refinement and then pulling it out to the wider sets of centres. So it's that type of model, I think, allows us to maybe be a bit more fleet of foot than maybe we were traditionally.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thank you for that. Ross Greer, are you ready to go through your questions?
Yeah, thank you.
Oh, yes, okay. Yes, sorry. Thank you.
That's all right, convener. Just to have a wee supplementary on that there as well. I'm just wondering too, obviously, you know, we learned about wellbeing being absolutely central to young people's learning and performance. And really interesting to hear you talking about that evaluation work there. And I'm just wondering, what are young people telling you about their learning experiences, and how is that idea of keeping their wellbeing at the centre of reform? What's actually happening with that just now? What differences has that made?
Yeah. I think that's a really important point. I mentioned assessment arrangements earlier, and actually we are able to put in place with schools and colleges particular arrangements for learners who may find it difficult, for example, to sit in an exam hall or indeed undertake an exam in particular set of circumstances. So there's quite a lot of flexibility that we have, building on an approach that's long-standing, which has to support the system to make sure that we are playing our part in supporting young people and the arrangements that may suit them best. We also, over the last couple of years, through the National Qualifications Group, have sought to ensure that we are providing as much support and also signalling sources of support to young people who undoubtedly have had it's been a tough couple of years, in particular, over the last couple of years for many young people. So just making sure that we are taking every step that we can, both to signal the support that's available and play our part in all of that. As well as that very clear additional support that we can provide through assessment arrangements.
Well, see, when you're talking about the assessment itself there as well, certainly we heard some views previously from, you know, children who were care experienced or neurodiversity or whatever, and there were some positives to pull from COVID as well that they felt too. So what is it that's actually happening on the ground? What kind of things are now in place that weren't there before for these young people?
Well, I think that point about flexibility is really important. So just so we've certainly seen an increase in the number of young people who wish to undertake their assessments in separate accommodation, for example, or have extra time to undertake assessments. We do, you know, through our work on our evaluation of our approach, we also have absolutely sought the views of learners on their experience of the last couple of years, and we'll continue to do that this year with a further approach to evaluation. So it's really important that we listen. We do a lot of work with Who Cares Scotland, for example, in relation to both supporting and celebrating the success of learners from care experienced backgrounds. And so I think I think it's really important that we're listening and mindful of the experience that young people have had, and we take every effort that we can to put arrangements in place that are appropriate for them. And I think we do that. We did provide some data on results day in relation to assessment arrangements, for example. But I think the point that Robert's made in relation to the accessibility and the choice that our qualifications provide to suit the needs of a range of learners is really important. And, you know, I think we've highlighted already, there's obviously a big focus on hires and national fives and advanced hire, but we have a wide range of qualifications that will suit the needs of many learners, including who may have a range of different experiences or indeed wish to take a different set of qualifications.
Robert, please.
Just very, very quickly, I mean, just again to back up that, but also in the interest also of, you know, promoting, I think, our strong catalogue, Mental Health Awareness Award, yes. Which we put in place fairly recently. We've had thousands and thousands of amazing interest and thousands of uptake, you know, and I think it's a critical example of where, you know, that there's a recognition that we've got a part to play to help support that awareness, and people have some practical techniques that can help them with that.
And that particular award, there's been some really, Robert's absolutely right to highlight it. There's been some fantastic engagement with that particular award, and some school-wide, and out with the context of S4 to S6, some learners are looking at that, for example, and S is part of their S3 learning, so not just in the senior phase, and that's all great.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Stephanie. Now, can we move on to Ross Greer now? Apologies for earlier.
Thanks, Convener. No problem. I thought the Mental Health Awareness Award's excellent, so I'm glad that came up on the record. Throughout this morning, the study guides that were produced this spring have come up a number of times, and I'm sure you're aware of the criticism that a lot of young people had of those guides around some of the advice in them that they felt was patronising. So, for example, the Advanced Higher Modern Studies paper encourages young people to make sure you answer the question asked in the exam. The Higher Physics and Chemistry papers urge them, it's always a good idea to spell words correctly. Higher Geography says you should read the question. Do you accept now that at least some of the content in those papers was patronising and not of particularly high value to a 17-year-old?
The revision support was put in place because there was additional disruption to learning, and of course we needed to provide a revision support across all 120 plus courses, and we sought to provide as much revision support as we could whilst maintaining the credibility of the qualifications. There's a judgment about I can talk a little bit about those subjects for which we were only providing a very brief study guide. It was effectively a study guide as opposed to revision support, and those tips were absolutely well meant. And indeed, you know, having sat through many grade boundary meetings, you know, that without wishing to trivialise it, answering the question is actually quite important when you're taking exams, and remains a credible piece of advice for all learners. But when we were looking at what we could do in revision support, we were looking at the combination of the modifications to assessment that had already been made and what more we could do that would be both helpful to learners but also not undermine the credibility of the qualifications. So it was for that reason that the revision support for different subjects, as you've highlighted, was different. So in some cases, we felt that we could not go any further than we already had through the modifications to assessment. And
been better? Because I accept that some courses were modified more than others or in ways that were significantly different. In hindsight, though, would it have been better with the study material that you published in spring to re-emphasise for those courses the modifications that had already been made rather than publish papers that on the face of it just looked much thinner?
Absolutely. And actually, that's what we did. That's what we effectively did within a few days of the revision support being sent out. I mean, I would acknowledge there was quite a lot of noise about revision support, but we also did get some really positive feedback on the revision support. And Robert and I sat with markers and principal assessors during the marking process and the grade boundary process. And actually, we saw that revision support had worked. So, for example, I think Robert mentioned for English, being able to specify the texts that were being presented to learners did provide assistance to learners in focusing their study. Now, because we don't have that assessment approach for every subject, we couldn't do it for every subject. But for maths, we provided information about what would not be assessed. And again, I think we saw evidence that that did help learners. So we've had some quite... I absolutely accept that there was some criticism, but overall the revision support helped learners who had faced disruption, and absolutely it needed to be taken in combination with the modifications assessment. There's always learning from these things. We'd never provided revision support before, absolutely understand the point you're making, but the revision support worked.
And I agree absolutely that some of the revision support was of really high quality. I think it was that variation that caused a lot of frustration for young people.
The variation did reflect the fact that the modification, we needed to look at the modification.
In that case, the issue here is an initial communication failure. And on that, can I just check, how were young people involved in the development of the revision materials? So you've got young people on the National Qualifications Group, you've got a learner panel. How were they involved in the construction of this? And did they flag up at any point that it's perhaps a bit patronising to say it's a good idea to spell words correctly?
Robert can come in here because he was closer to that process of engagement than I was. But we did get good feedback. I mean, obviously, some elements of the revision support were difficult to share in advance because of the nature of them, in particular, given that it wasn't clear whether the scenario two, which invoked revision support, would be put in place. So I hope you understand that we had to be quite careful.
The specifics about, for example, an exam paper obviously clearly can't be shared in advance, but there's nothing compromising about sharing in advance the paper's going to encourage them to spell words correctly. And I presume if you'd share that in advance with them, that some
indeed.
Concerns
okay,
might be
Ross,
raised.
Okay, Ross, can we perhaps let Robert answer some...
We did do that.
Thanks.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose just... Yeah, where we could, we trialled some of that support and actually got quite positive feedback. I mean, obviously, those points that you referenced, you know, have to be taken in the context of the full guide rather than just, you know, those particular points around that. You know, so there was other elements of the guidance, I think, that was, you know, you could argue would be more valuable in that context. But we did some work with young learners, and certainly I saw some feedback that was relatively was positive. But I do think, you know, it's a good point for reflection. It always is, you know, and how we position the vision support in the context of the full modifications is certainly the learning point for me.
So on that point around reflection, so I've sat in this committee for 6 years. 5 years ago, this committee did a major report into the SQA under your predecessor, Fiona, and a consistent point of criticism of the organisation has been a perceived defensiveness around external feedback, advice, criticism, etc. We've gone through the process where Cameron Garrett, the first member of the Youth Parliament on the National Qualifications Group, was critical of how young people were treated through that process. Sophie Reid, who succeeded him, is now being critical of a lack of communication, a breakdown of trust. I'm going to preempt your answer somewhat and presume that you're going to say that there has been improvement over recent years. So accepting that's the premise, why do you think nobody else sees that improvement?
I don't think it would be fair to say that no one else sees that improvement. You know, we've worked tirelessly to ensure that there's effective communication about the changes. You know, it has been a very, I think it's been a challenging in context for everyone working in education, including SQA. I think we have moved to engage much more strongly with learners than has been the case in the past. I think there have been times where there have been differences of view, and we've had to take some difficult decisions in relation. For example, I know Cameron was particularly concerned about symmetric appeals, that appeals could go up as well as down. But that's a really good example of the fact that we have to work on the basis of the evidence in front of us, and the central principle of demonstrated attainment is such that we have a responsibility, including a statutory responsibility, to ensure that we award only on the basis of the evidence that's presented to us. So that didn't indicate lack of engagement. That indicated that we needed to take a difficult decision around some of these issues. I think there's always more to do. I think SQA and many other organisations over the last few years have absolutely been on a journey around some of these issues, because we've had to flex our approach in very demanding circumstances where there's actually been very little time for reflection. We've had to move very quickly, but we've sought as far as possible to take people with us, to take the wider education community with us, learners, parents, and those that are also delivering across education as much as we can. But there is absolutely more that we will continue to do in that context.
I'm afraid we have to move on in the purpose of time. We'll come back to those if there's time.
Yeah, thanks. It's just a yes, no. So if there's time at the end, that'd be ideal.
Thank you. Can I ask Bob Doris now? He has some questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Earlier on, we got good clarity that the syllabus for students didn't shrink, and the course requirements in terms of content didn't shrink, but what was narrowed was the externally examined aspects of the curriculum. So that was helpful. We know that's going to be the same situation again in the current year for the exam results, which will come out in August 2023. When would SQA anticipate returning back to, if you like, the pre-pandemic breadth of content for external examination? That would be helpful. So there's that, convener. Also, given the fact that we have a degree of consistency with August 23's awards and August 22's awards, are those by and large going to be comparable? Because we have issues about comparability. That would be helpful as well. And for time constraints, I'll roll it into a third aspect of the question. Given that, and I've got a note of the three, so later answers to all three, that'd be really helpful. Given that Professor Louise Hayward's looking at what should be externally examined and that balance more generally, might it be anticipated that the SQA doesn't return to the previous levels of external assessment because Professor Hayward might recommend something completely different? So why would you return to the old way of doing things when we're in a transition stage to a new way of doing things? So three aspects to that, which hopefully you can pick up all three.
So I'll try and be brief. There's a number of parts to that. So on the narrowing of external assessment, we've confirmed the position for this year, and we will do in 2023-24, we will also consider with the system whether modifications should continue further into 2023-24 or not. We haven't made a decision yet on that, but we have made a decision in relation to this academic year that the modifications to assessment. My own view is that you know, coursework, coursework's been taken out. It's not universal. I think there's a lot of support for coursework and for ensuring that young people have the ability to undertake practical work. Now, it remains part of the course specification, and I hope that in terms of learning and teaching, that will be covered. But I would like to see that move back as soon as we can. But I think we need to remain flexible to the circumstances that learners have faced. And in a small number of subjects, we did move back in 2021-22. In relation to comparability, I think, as I highlighted in my opening statement, there are some issues that we will need to confirm with the system. We've confirmed modifications to assessment. We need to reflect on the experience of 2022 in relation to generous awarding. We also need to consider that in the context of the wider education system. And so we will need to consider that further. But I would like there to be some consideration of that, bearing in mind the circumstances that are in place at the time. And for Louise Hayward's review, yes, we're playing a full part in Louise's work, and Louise will wish to consider what the balance of assessment, both when and how. My only note of caution around change is that the feedback from the last round of reforms to qualifications was that we needed to make sure that implementation was considered very carefully, and that included investment in the system and capacity building in the system. So reforms to qualifications can take some time, and I think we need to keep that very much in mind in the context of how we move forward.
I know Mr Quinn wants to come in, yeah. Convener, but I'm just conscious, I think you've said you're not sure if it's going to be comparable, rather than yes or no. I think you've said that you might continue with this same method for the following academic year, but you might not, and you'd quite like to go back to some of the old ways of working. And lots of the systems in flux at the moment. There's a huge amount of stability would be really good for young people in schools, yeah. I think. And I'm just a wee bit disappointed that we don't have more clarity from the SQA in relation to this.
I think we had a really important we had a conversation with the system yesterday through the NQ group, and I think the NQ group were conscious that we had put certainty in place for the modifications. So there's certainty around learning and teaching. Okay, there is certainty, and that's been welcomed by the system. But what I'm saying is, it is important that yes, we need to work at pace, but we also need to ensure that we're reflecting with the system on the experience of the last year in order to make those decisions. So I don't want you to misunderstand my the fact that I'm not being unequivocal in my response, but it's important, as we have done, to consider those issues further and be flexible in our thinking, because we don't know what the year will bring. So, and that's been a really important part of our approach to date.
Okay.
Sure. Please.
Yeah, just quickly on the last point that about kind of reflections on Hayward or reflections on the modifications, etc. And I agree with what Fiona's saying around we want to give certainty, and I think by the end of the year we want to give certainty as to how we're mapping it out. But I do think there's we have to continuously reflect on things. You know, there might be some aspects of the sampling that was introduced in the modifications or the, you know, our exam size, etc. These are things that we do have to give some reflections on, and I feel very strongly as well that we need to put coursework back in certain areas, because I do think that they're an important construct in terms of what we're trying to assess. But I do think in terms of point towards Hayward, etc. Yeah, there are things we can, but we need to get that concrete information out to centres in good and to teachers and learners in good time. But you know, we always should be reflecting.
I wouldn't come back in, but I thought that coursework never left because it was part of the syllabus, and it could have been internally assessed rather than returned to external examinations. Okay. But I'll leave that sitting there.
Okay, thanks. I know. Sorry, Robert. Graham's got a wee supplementary that you might be able to wrap in on the same topic, so it might all cover in what you want to say.
Thanks. Yeah, thank you, Convener, because this kind of moves on to something I was wanting to ask later on. We're not just talking about the next year, the next 2 years. We've got a cohort of young people, the impact of the pandemic on whom is going to be there. There's going to be a legacy impact for years to come. So it's important that we learn, I hate to use the phrase, learn the lessons of the last 3 years, but we do need to learn that to adapt our approach to assessment, do we not? So there's a level playing field for these young people. So I think it's really important to understand, you said there that you were feeding into Louise Hayward's work. What is it you're feeding in? What are the lessons that we learned from the last 3 years? What have we learned we could be doing better? in terms of, you know, approaches to certification, the impact, the distribution of grades, that all young people's learning journeys. I mean, you talked earlier about the modification arrangements being in place. You talked about alternative evidence. What are you sitting today that you can take away from the last 3 years that you think should be embedded in the approach moving forward?
No, I think that's a really important point. I mean, I think it's absolutely critical that we learn from the experience, not just of the last 2 years, important though those have been, but also learning from the experience of the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence and our aspirations of Curriculum for Excellence. And we have done some work on that, and that has been shared with Louise Hayward. We've also shared some work in relation to how other systems organise themselves to deliver assessments, because, you know, there are differences across the world and different arrangements, but we do need to look at this as a system. This is not just about what the qualification, and we absolutely do, it's not just about the qualifications body, it's also about the implications for those that are delivering qualifications, those that are in receipt of that learning and teaching, and those that are achieving qualifications. We have also done some evaluation work on the alternative certification approach in 2021, and that will be published soon. And there's an evaluation plan around 2022. So that does involve discussions with learners, with practitioners, with school leaders and others, and college leaders, so to ensure that experience
sneak
is
reflected. Sneak preview of this evaluation that you're about to publish. What have you been told about the approach that was taken?
You'll need to await the full detail in the evaluation, but we have shared some messages with the in-group and others. And actually, I think in 2021, with the alternative certification model, it's quite clear that some learners had a very positive experience, but some learners did not. You know, so I think that there was certainly variation in the experience, and I think there was some reflection from practitioners about the role of teacher judgment in the process of delivering qualifications. So there is absolutely learning for SQA in the work that we did both in 2021, and I'm sure there certainly will be for 2022. But there's also wider learning for the system, and I think that will inform our consideration of what Scotland wants and what Scotland will need going forward. And so I think that will be really. That will be really important. But SQA also sits on a lot of evidence, and, you know, I've had discussions with Louise Hayward to ensure that and skill and expertise of the staff of SQA, I think it's going to be really important to ensure that breadth of experience, not just in SQA, but right across the system, is brought to bear in considering the assessment and qualifications system that Scotland wants.
Sorry, I know Robert Quinn's want to come in. It's important that evaluation information is provided, because you shouldn't be left to mark your own homework.
Yeah.
So I think it's really important. I think this committee will look forward to seeing this evaluation work. Sorry.
I'm just to let Robert come in, that was all.
Just more on the broader question about lessons learned and reflections. For me, and not just pandemic related, but obviously it's been accelerated via the pandemic, we need time and space for innovation and assessment is a critical. I think the mistakes we've made in the past is we've tried to push through changes too quickly without properly resourcing it, and that's across the system. I don't just mean SQA resource, but I mean across the system. So I think time and space for people to get the handle. I think a continued journey towards understanding standards. The work our SQA staff did amazing work in the pandemic, really trying to exemplify and help centres understand standards. And one of the benefits of the pandemic, actually, a few benefits, is that young teachers now are much more attuned with assessment standards than they were ever before, because they've had to get to grips with it. And I think that rich understanding standards, what that front-end quality assurance, is really important. And obviously, I think harnessing the role of technology and supporting teaching, learning and assessment is another critical thing that we need to learn. So these are just some of the things that when you asked about, you know, what are the reflections that come to mind.
And all that will be fed into the review.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Kavir.
No, thank you for that. I've purposely been watching the clock, because I want to spend the last session, last part of this session, sort of doing some questions around the reform agenda. And with that, I want to hand over to start off this section on to Michael Mara, please.
Thanks, Convener. You may have picked up on the session we had with Education Scotland prior to the summer recess, where senior officials came in and told committee that they weren't being scrapped as an organisation. I think that it's fair to say that the Scottish Government have been very clear on this fact and on the status of the SQA as well. What I wanted to ask really in the first instance is what, in your view, will be different about Scotland's qualification agency after this process is completed?
Okay. So the Scottish Government have confirmed that there will be a new public body, just for the avoidance of doubt, for developing and awarding qualifications, and it will replace SQA. So I think we are clear, and I am clear, that SQA is being replaced. This is a Scottish Government education reform programme. We are engaging closely with the Scottish Government and others on that and participating in that reform programme, as you would expect. I've highlighted the skills and expertise of staff right across SQA, and I think that's important that it's brought to bear in considering new as well. I think there are a number of signals around how the Cabinet Secretary wishes to see change. She's already highlighted potentially some changes to the governance structure, and of course the Scottish Government do set the context for the governance structure within SQA as a public body at the moment, so some changes to the governance structure. And in particular around in the context of some of the reform work, there's a deadline of the end of the year to work on a target operating model for the new body, which will in particular be looking at user-led, service-led approach to delivery. So I think that will be really important in considering some of the changes that we might make. But I think it's also important to highlight, and the Hayward Review's come up in the context of the discussion today, that in considering the form of the new public body, of a new public body, we do need to consider function more, very clearly. And if the conclusion of Louise Hayward's work is that we have a different assessment and qualification system in Scotland, that will have a bearing, and I think we've alluded to this in the context of the developments around qualifications and the resource required, that will have a bearing on what the new qualifications body looks like. There's one element of function in broad terms which is not yet clear, and Scottish Government is considering further the accreditation function within SQA, and so that's not yet, that work has not yet been completed. So that's still one element.
That point, Ken Muir's report was really quite clear on this, the recommending the separation of awarding functions from accreditation and regulation. And do you think that's going to be taken forward, that separation, a very clear recommendation?
Well, Ken Muir's report was clear in his recommendation, but the Scottish Government was also pretty clear in its response to the recommendation, was that they would wish to consider it further before making a final decision, and that work is underway. And SQA was also clear in its response to the consultation on the Muir review about its position in relation to that, and that remains the case.
This, you're saying that this is a Scottish Government process being led by them. But I've been passed a list of the membership of the new Qualifications Delivery Board. So there are 7 members of that board, 6 of whom are SQA managers.
I haven't seen the list that you have, but I don't think that's quite correct. My colleague.
I'm more than happy to come in here.
Yeah, Mike.
I chair the Delivery Board. And that Delivery Board kind of stress reports into the Scottish Government through the Strategic Board, which is chaired by them. There are a number of non-SQA members that sit on the Delivery Board representing the education sector across Scotland, colleges, the skills and training sector. We have a Director of Education. We sought nomination from School Leaders Scotland. We have a further external member who is experience of awarding and regulation out with Scotland to provide independent and external challenge.
So there's four non-executive directors at the moment on that, above the board members. That makes up 11, the majority of which six are employees of the SQA. So I suppose where I'm going with this is that there's some concern, I think, expressed by members of the committee and external organisations that, just like Education Scotland, there might be a concern that what we're looking at is a rebrand here rather than actually a replacement or a substantive reform.
Can I say that, you know, through the reform programme, I think we and I think everybody that's involved in it is ambitious to make sure that we have a qualifications body moving forward that serves the needs of the people that we serve in the best possible way. And we've touched on some of the themes in the discussion this morning.
The tone, I think, in terms of, the conclusion that the government has come to is that this organisation, I think in contrast to much of your submission to the committee today and to what we've heard, is the organisation has failed in recent years. That is the conclusion of the government. I'm afraid they wouldn't be scrapping the organisation otherwise. The question now is what replaces it. And it strikes me that if we're looking at a system that is driven by management of the existing organisation, and we're being told by some of the organisations they're not even being scrapped, can we really have faith that this is a reform process that is based in the needs of people? Should it not be external voices that are being heard? Should it not be people represented here who are the users in the process to actually make these decisions, rather than the six SQA managers, including yourself, Mr. Baxter, who I've listed on this piece of paper?
The delivery board, the composition of the delivery board is balanced across both the skills and expertise and experience and knowledge of existing SQA staff, and it will crucially also involve a wider staff group, as it should, as I'm sure you would support, and at the same time some external voices and engagement. But it doesn't stop and start with the delivery board. This is a conversation you may wish to have with the Scottish Government, ministers yourself, around the broader education reform programme and how it interacts with the national discussion, which will obviously be broad and wide, and also Louise Hayward's review on assessment and qualifications, the what we do, which has formed the basis of much of this discussion this morning, and quite rightly so. So I think this is actually quite a broad and wide conversation going on, and there will be a lot of user engagement and consultation around this process. So I think it's important that you do, that while I think it's really important that you and the committee understand the strength of experience in the delivery board, that it doesn't stop there in the context of the wider reform programme. There's a strategic board. I do sit on the strategic board, but there's a wide range of stakeholders on the strategic board around reform. That's chaired by a Scottish Government civil servant. My understanding is, as part of this work, there's a stakeholder engagement group that the Cabinet Secretary is chairing, and I think that group meets quite soon. So, you know, it's probably not for me to talk through the detail of the Scottish Government's education reform programme, but I think I can give you an assurance that we've been working closely with the Scottish Government to agree the approach and our involvement in that approach to ensure that the experience and skills of staff are taken account of in this process.
I get that, and I suppose I'm just trying to, you know, given what Michael Mara said in terms of the membership of this review, how I'm just concerned, and again with the comment about the rebrand, how different in function is a national award body going to be if it's currently being reviewed by the people that are in the existing organisation? And that's the sort of, it's the seismic shift. We need a change and reform, but is it going to be significant enough to do what's expected?
So can I come in there? I think that we need to be clear about what the role of the delivery board is and what it isn't. So the delivery board is there to fulfil a commission from the government to come up with proposals. And in doing so, the delivery board and the work that supports it will need to engage, and that's part of the commission, is to engage with a wide range of stakeholders to form those proposals. So it's not simply by SQA marking its own homework as it's been characterised. So I think that's important to say. There are a number of interdependencies here, to come back to your question about what's going to be different. At the same time that reform is taking place, SQA as an organisation will need to continue to deliver its existing functions. And you know, the awarding of qualifications will need to be done in a safe and secure way. And to undertake a significant programme of reform at the same time of delivering existing functions is going to be a real challenge. And I think we need to be clear about what the transition to the new organisation will be and the implications, therefore, of Louise Hayward's work, the national conversation, and a continued period of change for that new body once it's in existence. And I think that's the reality of where we are. But I do think that we need to take a progressive look at this. It's simply not about the status quo. I can absolutely assure the committee of that.
I think the committee would recognise the challenge of undertaking both those functions at the same time. But my answer to that would be, is why is it taking quite so long in terms of years of a transition process with a national conversation layered after a conclusion around the qualifications review? And that actually is the point that exacerbates the problem. Fiona Robertson, the issue with this is that, you know, when I say the organisation has failed, that is the conclusion of the ministers, and you shake your head again at that. The organisation is being closed and replaced now for decisions that it took. That's the ministerial, the cabinet secretary took those decisions, I assume at cabinet with the imprimatur of the first minister on that basis, a significant change. It's taking years, and the problems that Mr Baxter describes in terms of running a system whilst reforming a system are of the making of that reform process. My belief that that could happen an awful lot quicker than it is at the moment. And actually, those problems have been created by a situation that's been pulled out over a period of years.
A couple of things. First of all, you know, I don't accept that's what the Cabinet Secretary has said in her rationale for change. But second of all, in the context of the speed at which reform can take place, I think Mike's point is really important, that it is critical that we maintain continuity of delivery whilst also investing in reform. To create a new qualifications body, we will need legislation, and legislation takes time. This committee will wish to scrutinise said legislation, and will absolutely take its time as absolutely appropriate to do that. Now, the programme for government that was published yesterday did set out that there would be an education reform bill in this parliamentary year.
On that point, it's up to Parliament to decide how quickly it scrutinises legislation and how quickly that takes and the priority it gives to it. The government are the people who are setting the terms of how long this review process is taking. So if I can, the point of how quickly we prosecute that legislation is up to us. Mm-hmm. It's not necessarily for comment of other people.
No,
I think we should do
it
more quickly. Review process, convener. Yeah.
I was really just highlighting the fact that there are steps to go through here between both in the transition and the transformation that we want to see. So, and I think it's really important that we understand that needs to be done properly, and it needs to be done well, and that will take some time. Now, the government, as part of the education reform programme, have highlighted the expectation that a new body will be in place after results on 2024, and their timeline reflects that broad commitment. And my job and our job is to make sure that we are contributing to that work, drawing on the skills and experience of SQA staff. I think you would expect in any public sector reform programme that there is engagement with those that are currently delivering those functions. Ken Muir has been clear about the broad continuity of functions. So the point that the convener you made about functions, that's been part of Ken's review, with the exception as things stand on accreditation. And the issue is what further changes do we expect from our assessment and qualification system, and therefore what changes the organisation need to be reflected as part of that, beyond what the Cabinet Secretary has already said. But I do think that detailed questions in relation to the Scottish Government's education reform programme would probably be best dealt with by the Scottish Government. I can certainly comment, and happy to do so, on the elements of the programme that pertain to us, and we're working hard to deliver on that.
Thank you, Fiona. I've got some supplementaries to come in still. I've got one from Stephanie, and then I've got one from Graham. So we'll take Stephanie first. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Convener. Mike, you spoke about the delivery board fulfilling a commission, and I really appreciate the fact that you need that experience, the knowledge, the skills actually on there too. So you've got the leadership teams then from the Scottish Government, SQA and Education Scotland, working together within the existence, governance, frameworks, accountability there to establish a new organisation. So I'm wondering, is it working well, and what positive progress has actually been made on that? Thanks.
Yeah, if I can respond. I think the engagement has been extremely good between various organisations. I think from the announcement back in March this year and the outcome of Ken Muir's report and the Scottish Government's response to it, it's quite a lot of the detail around the implications of Ken Muir's report and taking it forward that needed to be worked through still at that point. And we've been seeking to do that and engaging positively around that. I think with any major change programme or programme of reform, it's important to set that off on the right track. So the commission that's been set by Scottish Government for the delivery board sets out a programme of deliverables or work over the next 18 months or so that will help to arrive at decisions around the nature of the new qualifications body. And that's the work that we're taking forward. We absolutely are committed to engaging with stakeholders as we take forward that work. I think there's been, you know, discussion this morning in the committee around some of the strengths and opportunities that committee members would see for the new qualifications body. And it's really important that we explore those fully in terms of what we're able to deliver against the challenging backdrop that's been set out. Also, I think a point that's been made on a couple of occasions is, whilst the focus is on structural reform of the national agencies, we don't sit in a vacuum. So looking at the implications of any change on the wider education system and the deliverability of that change, it's important that is worked through. I don't say that from the point of view of trying to, you know, pad this out, but actually making sure that we get this right and that the implementation of change is taken forward in a logical and deliverable way is absolutely where we need to get to.
Thank you.
And I'm just wondering the biggest challenges that you've come up against?
I think the biggest challenge, if I'm speaking from personal capacity here as chair of the delivery board, I think is recognising the ongoing challenges around delivery for SQA as an organisation and a challenging operating environment. Successful delivering awarding, the confidence that's been talked about today is important that we continue, not just for our learners, but for the services that we provide to, through our contracts, etc., and continuity of those. So those are big challenges that we need to recognise and work our way through, and resourcing becomes an important part of that.
Thank you. Can I move over to Graham now, just keeping an eye on the time?
Yeah, thank you. It's not just about how this is done, it's also about the appearance of how it's done. And Mr. Mara makes a point that to have the SQA so dominant in this process, at face value, could be questioned by those who fear a rebranding and nothing more. So what assurance is there, and I mean real assurance, that this is a genuine process to look to get us to a point where we need to be, where it's been made clear that we need to be, not just in terms of forming a new body, but the ethos of that body, and that the perfectly legitimate input that SQA might have, both in a broader sense, but also over the last 2 years, is taken on board. But we're looking at this afresh. So how is this oversight organisation that you're running, Mr. Baxter, actually operating in principle, in practice rather?
So I think that The oversight organisation, I think, it, just to be clear, it's a delivery board that's delivering against a commission from the Scottish Government, so it's not been created as a separate organisation. The work that we're taking forward will need to be validated. So this isn't, you know, it's not a decision for SQA in terms of this is the form and function of the new delivery body. The delivery board, and with the expertise that's been alluded to, will create proposals that will go to the Scottish Government and be reviewed, okay, involving external stakeholders. So, you know, involvement of stakeholders at an early stage of this work is really, really important. Credibility of the work is really important. And, you know, I don't underestimate the amount of work that's involved in this, but we have a real opportunity here, and I think it's important that we grasp that.
So in practice, how many times has the Oversight Board met? How does it operate? I mean, how are these external stakeholders input into this process?
So the Delivery Board met for the first time in August, with the confirmation of membership. It is an open discussion. We have the commission against which we are tracking performance and work. So the analysis that's undertaken is really about our delivery against that commission for Scottish Government. What the external members are bringing to the table is different perspectives on what they would want to see from the output of that work.
So are we operating in a way that looks to the end destination, what it is we want to achieve, and then working how we best get there, as opposed to simply tweaking existing practice and approach?
So this in part for me is at the nub, because whilst there are, in Ken Muir's report and the response, there are general words around the ethos or, you know, better learner engagement or whatever, it's about how do you articulate that and then how do you deliver that? And that's what we're working through at this point in time. So the target operating model will you know, establish that kind of mission, vision, etc., for the new organisation, from which then will flow some of the detailed organisational work that's required thereafter.
Thanks, Camille. Okay.
Thank you very much. And I'd like to... that was the last questions we've got time for. Keeping an eye on the clock, I'd like to thank you all for your time today and for the participation of the three members from the SQA. Thank you very much. The public part of today's meeting is now at an end, and we'll now consider our final agenda item in private. Thank you very much. Thank you.